Hi, I'm Dr. Mara Simopoulou, clinical embryologist geneticist and associate professor at the Medical School of Athens. My contribution with this video aims to communicate innovations and new techniques in IVF treatment in Greece. So Greece has always been a popular holiday destination, we all know that, and in the past decade it has evolved into one of the top countries for medical tourism, what we call cross-border reproductive care. But why is Greece a valid option? Well, choosing to undergo IVF in Greece is a valid option due to the competitive pricing, the high standards of care, the short waiting time for treatment, as well as due to the advanced level of expertise and experience of IVF specialists, some of them contributing with substantial and world-renowned scientific research. Having had the privilege of collaborating and visiting IVF clinics all over the world, from the UK to the USA, Canada, Malta, Turkey, I can say that indeed Greece is a favorable destination for all the reasons mentioned above. And what is more, current legislation referring to assisted reproductive techniques is considerably patient-friendly amongst other European countries. There are further drivers making Greece an attractive option. The age limit for women undergoing IVF treatment is 50 years of age. Moreover, oocyte and sperm donors are protected by anonymity, while the good donor viability leads to a practically minimal waiting list for egg and sperm donation. Finally, single women are eligible for treatment and can exercise their reproductive autonomy right, having fertility treatment in Greece. Fertility treatments are rapidly developing and there is an influx of innovative approaches for enhancing clinical outcome having been introduced. Some of them are at an experimental status while others have achieved clinical routine practice. But in Greece, there are several research and development groups that are working really hard, especially in the last 5 years, performing high quality research in the field of reproductive medicine. Considering the field of reproductive regenerative medicine and as evidence in literature, there are novel approaches for addressing ovarian insufficiency that have been first reported by Greek scientists. An example of that is the autologous platelet-rich plasma, in short PRP, intra-ovarian infusion treatment, and the mitochondrial replacement therapy, also known as MRT approach. Both of these techniques are at the experimental stage and both are running randomized controlled trials in Greece. So let's start with PRP. It is well known that aging, aka advanced maternal age, poor ovarian reserve, and premature ovarian insufficiency are all conditions related to reduced ovarian blood flow. The molecular network that is promoting the formation of new vessels is reported to be significantly disrupted in these patients that are presenting with ovarian insufficiency. And this deficiency in vascularization is considered to be one of the main factors contributing to the impairment of ovarian functionality. However, studies indicate that this condition may well be reversed and follicular growth could be reactivated and stimulated when the compromised ovarian microenvironment is restored. In fact, there are numerous observations with respect to the angiogenetic structure of the ovaries, along with the vascular activation that is promoted by several platelet-derived factors, encourage Greek scientists to test the hypothesis that autologous PRP intra-ovarian infusion treatment may in fact be able to induce reactivation of the dysfunctional tissue. In fact, it is highlighted that PRP may play an important role in the ovarian niche restoration, mainly through the promotion of physiological processes of angiogenesis, proliferation, growth, apoptosis, inflammation control, as well as cell migration. There is data provided from publication in international peer-reviewed journals indicating that PRP treatment may be an effective solution for addressing ovarian insufficiency. In other words, the answer to the question, does it work, is yes, it may work, but not for every patient and not always to the same extent. It appears that PRP may be effective, it may promote folliculogenesis and restore the compromised ovarian niche. Nonetheless, the extent of success is yet to be defined, as PRP may not work for all patients that it is administered to, it may not work within the same time frame while its results may not last for the same period. But this is understandable when we consider the ovarian insufficiency and the fact that it's characterized by high heterogeneity, and this is the main issue here. Therefore, it appears that it can work for some patients, but the real question is for whom? So the next step is for research to provide us with answers in identifying these patients, and that will allow us in the era of precision medicine to predict a good candidate for PRP. Of course, similarly to every innovative and novel technique, the final verdict is yet to be provided, but as I said before, there are 4 randomized controlled trials that are currently being conducted in order to provide robust data regarding PRP's efficiency and safety in poor responders, premature ovarian insufficiency patients, perimenopausal and menopausal women. Information with regard to these RCTs is provided in clinicaltrials.gov. So let's move over to the mitochondrial replacement therapy, in short MRT, which has been proposed as a novel approach for improving oocyte quality in patients presenting with ovarian insufficiency. Mitochondria are identified as the powerhouse of the cell, the energy factor of the cell, if you like, and their role is in their development of the preimplantation embryo has been extensively investigated. Provided data indicate that the processes of fertilization and proper embryonic development require great amounts of cellular energy, which is produced by mitochondria. We know that, that is true. What is further a fact is that advanced maternal age, poor ovarian response, and premature ovarian insufficiency are all conditions that are related to compromised mitochondrial functionality. So the idea behind this approach is to test the hypothesis that the employment of mitochondria from a young, healthy donor could in theory provide the pre-implantation embryo with a better and more potent developmental potential. And this is what we're all after during the early stages. This is what served as the driver leading to early attempts of mitochondrial replacement therapy, which was initially approached by performing all-plasmic transfer. But although plasmic transfer presented with success in enabling an improvement in embryo quality, resulting to reports of clinical pregnancy and live birth, the FDA decided to ban its application back in 2001 due to ethical and medical concerns that are mainly related to heteroplasmy and interrelated adverse effects. Fast forward to today, more than a decade following FDA ban, novel approaches regarding mitochondrial transfer have been introduced, this time in order to provide and improve oocyte quality. MRT could be autologous or heterologous, and recently published data indicate that autologous MRT may not be such a good idea for the reasons mentioned above. There are four protocols available for heterologous MRT, namely PNT, the polar body transfer, the maternal spindle transfer, and the germinal vesicle transfer. The first RCT with regard to the maternal spindle transfer technique is conducted by a research group in Greece in poor patients. The clinical trial has so far resulted in two live births. However, and despite these promising results, this technique has raised considerable ethical concerns. The European Society of Human Reproduction and Embryology issued a formal thesis on strong discouragement and disapproval regarding the technique's application in the context of addressing poor ovarian response, and actually urged practitioners to refrain from adopting the clinical practice of MST for anything else other than to avoid transmission of a mitochondrial inherited disorder, for which case there is no other alternative. So it is strictly this approach that has claimed regulation status by the HFEA, the Human and Fertilization Embryology Authority, in the United Kingdom. In the context of our treatment, there is a lack of robust data at the moment indicating the safety and effectiveness of the method, which currently maintains experimental status. So this concludes it, and it has been a brief presentation of the two most novel and cutting-edge approaches on addressing ovarian insufficiency in Greece at the moment. So, in the era of precision medicine, artificial intelligence, and bioinformatics, we have yet to learn so much more. In the meantime, what we can all do is move forward, focusing on how to better and more effectively address conundrums such as ovarian insufficiency in the IVF context, and ultimately help these patients. I hope this has been helpful in providing you with information on the most innovative approaches on the matter of ovarian insufficiency in Greece. Thanks very much.